Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 13th June 2020. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been provided along with the page numbers of different editions of Hindu newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description box and also in the comment section. Let's move on to the first news article analysis for today. The first discussion for today is based on these three articles. The editorial article is with reference to learning in physical classroom together with other classmates versus learning online. The article presents two main arguments against making the online learning as a permanent program, and it also talks about Swayam program of Government of India. Then this Ground Zero article presents the challenges faced by both teachers and students in the places that have challenges regarding connectivity, electricity, etc. Then this news article from Bengaluru edition states that private schools have suspended online classes for pre-primary and lower primary students after the state government prohibited both live online classes and pre-recorded videos. So these three articles talk about physical classroom versus online learning. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. In this context, let us first discuss the editorial. This editorial is a response article to the recent move of UGC, that is University Grants Commission. Recently, in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic, UGC had encouraged universities to adopt massive open online courses, that is MOOC, offered on the Swayam platform. These courses are to be considered for credit transfers in the coming semesters. See, first know that Swayam stands for Study Webs of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds. It is a program initiated by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, and it is designed to achieve three cardinal principles of education policy. These cardinal principles are accessibility, equity, and quality. We will see how far these cardinal principles are to be achieved in our country in the end of this analysis. Now know that the objective of Swayam is to take the best teaching learning resources to all, including the most disadvantaged sections of population. It seeks to bridge the digital divide for two sets of students. One, so far remained untouched by the digital revolution. Then students who have not been able to join the mainstream of the knowledge economy. Therefore, Swayam is a platform that facilitates hosting of all the courses which are taught in classroom from class 9 till post-graduation. These classes can be accessed by anyone, anywhere, at any time. It presents various courses of different durations in these domains. And know that as on April 2020, around 1900 courses are offered in this platform, out of which around 1500 are self-learning courses. Now, with regards to this, author states that such online courses and online classes can only be a temporary alternative and it should not be made permanent for two important reasons. The first reason is that the MOOC based e-learning platforms reinforces a top-down teacher-to-student directionality of learning. Now in this approach, the teacher creates the content and the student just consumes it. There is no opportunity to practice dialogue, to practice debate, disagreement and friendship, which are very important for a wholesome and meaningful learning. Therefore, it is the physical classroom that is the best for having a debate and dialogue. In that way, a physical classroom becomes an essential laboratory for hands-on testing of ideas, opinions, interpretations, and counter-arguments. We can understand by taking an example of the debate sessions that happen in a news channel. We can see that how difficult it is to conduct a debate that includes 5 or 6 politicians in a news channel on a particular topic. Then imagine how it would be difficult if an online class has around 40 to 70 students. Then the second argument is that online learning or digital learning can only be a tool to promote engagement of learners in a physical classroom. For example, the use of projectors to display some images or online content in a physical classroom. In some universities, such a physical classroom is called as smart classroom. This means going digital is not smart in itself. Rather, it makes a physical classroom as a smart classroom that is heavily beneficial for the students. This means online learning cannot substitute physical classrooms. This is particularly true for children belonging to the classes up to 5th standard. In such scenario, author concludes that if classroom learning is permanently substituted with online learning, even after the pandemic has subsided, then it is nothing but the dilution of education. And to make it understandable, author compares online learning to an unsafe helmet that can only save us from paying penalty, and such learning is not comparable to a helmet that saves life when we suffer an accident. So these are the points noted by the author in this editorial. Now, if you see, the editorial is about making online learning a permanent feature, but the Ground Zero article is about the preconditions for online learning. The Ground Zero article talks about the basic infrastructure which are prerequisites to participate in online learning. So it presents the heavy challenges faced by the teachers and students in the northeastern region, specifically those who are in the border and other districts of Arunachal Pradesh. And especially the article talks about five districts in the state of Arunachal Pradesh. One is Anjar district. This district is the easternmost district in the state. It shares border with China and Myanmar. Then the article mentions about Tawang district, which is the westernmost district in the state. It is bordering China. Then Shiyomi district is also mentioned. It borders China. Then the article also mentions about West Siang district and East Siang district. You can observe that there are five districts with the name of Siang in it. And know that the name Siang is derived from the river Brahmaputra, as Brahmaputra is called as Siang River in Arunachal Pradesh. Now let us come back to the article discussion, which talks about the prerequisites of online learning. The basic requirement for online learning is a normally functioning computer or a smartphone. And secondly, internet connectivity and mobile network connectivity is needed. And thirdly, and more importantly, the seamless electricity to support internet modem and to charge the devices like computers or smartphone is needed. Because even though we have uninterrupted internet connectivity, if there is no electricity, there is no use of it. So even if there is lack of seamless electricity, there has to be uninterrupted power supply arrangements, that is UPS arrangements or inverter arrangements. So this means online learning can be met and be successful only if these conditions are met at the first place. It is extremely hard to have regular and consistent support of these basic infrastructure in many places in our country, we know that. And especially the students and learners in rural areas, in the northeastern region, in Jammu and Kashmir, and even in the Union Territory of Ladakh, always fall short of one or more of these important necessities. And this Ground Zero article presents an example where the situation is even worse in one area. The situation is worse to such a level that even to speak to a teacher over a mobile network, a girl has to walk for 7 hours. Now, in this juncture only, we have to analyze what has been proclaimed in the Swayam scheme can be achieved or not. That is, we saw that Swayam scheme is designed to achieve the three cardinal principles of education policy, which are access, equity, and quality. See, we may agree that there might be quality in the content that is delivered by experienced teachers. But to access the quality content, universal accessibility and affordable facilities are required. Now, to achieve equity, all individuals, irrespective of the place or location or the family income, they must be able to participate in these classes. But the problem is, in many places, students and learners do not have computer, internet connectivity, etc. For these students, the government must help and it must step in to provide either free facilities or facilities at highly subsidized rates. Or else these children will be left out of the online learning when the whole country is encouraged to promote online learning. Now, this situation is not only worse for the students, even some teachers who are in the disadvantaged locations may have computers and content, but they may not have proper internet connectivity, which is true in the case of many parts of Arunachal Pradesh. So the Ground Zero article highlights the plight undergone by a college faculty to travel more than 100 kilometers for getting internet connectivity to take online classes for his students. So these were the points mentioned in the Ground Zero article. Now, coming to this third news article from Bengaluru edition, it mentions that the private schools have suspended online classes for classes up to 5th standard. This has been done after the state government prohibited both publishing of live online classes and pre-recorded videos also. Therefore, as per the government, online classes should not substitute classroom teaching as it might affect students' mental well-being because students from other parts are able to learn, but they are unable to learn. So there is a fear that it will affect the children psychologically. Apart from this, there were also reports that some private schools charged extra or additional fees for teaching online. So based on that only, the state government of Karnataka has prohibited both publishing of live online classes and pre-recorded videos also. But this article also notes that the opinion about online learning is divided among the parents because some are supporting it and some are opposing it. And the reason for opposition could be the lack of prerequisites. Then the reason could be difficulty to cope with the online live classes. Then it could also be the digital divide observed among two groups of parents, where one side is with parents with technological know-how to guide their children, while others do not know how to guide their children with respect to technology. So in this scenario, what can the government do? because there is no clarity about the possible dates from which normalcy could return so that classes can start in a physical classroom. And now there's a scenario that online learning is the only alternative. So for this, there is a suggestion. That is, the government can start a program that has two main components. This program should complete the tasks in a period of 1 month or 2 months. During that period, children could be given printed handouts or soft copies that deals with learning, memory, and other value-based content for self-learning. One of the two main components is identification of students who face the lack of adequate infrastructure for online learning. Here, teachers facing challenges should also be identified. Then the second component should be providing the needed infrastructure to the identified students and teachers from the range of free of cost to subsidized prices. Such a program may involve the role of Universal Service Obligation Fund of Department of Telecommunications. So you know that this fund is utilized exclusively for meeting the Universal Service Obligation, which is one of the objectives of New Telecom Policy of 1999. This obligation refers to the provision of universal ICT service to all uncovered areas, rural areas, remote, hilly and tribal areas of our country. Such services must be capable of meeting the needs of the country's economy. In this way, government can support those who are facing challenges to equip themselves for the online learning. So that is all about this first discussion. So in this discussion, we discussed three different articles, of which one was editorial and one was ground zero. And we saw various drawbacks of online learning and what are the prerequisites to establish a successful online learning. And you might have observed that today we did not cover various advantages offered by the online learning. We will discuss the advantages on some other day in a relevant article. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. That is split practice question we discussed in the last session. Now, this next discussion is based on these three news articles, which talks about the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. This news article mentions that the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi has constituted an advisory committee of eminent experts to chart the way forward regarding various challenges that is being faced in Delhi while preventing the spread of COVID-19 disease. The committee will also provide measures to enhance the medical infrastructure. Now, this next news article talks about one issue of National Capital Territory of Delhi. We know that the country is rigorously fighting against the COVID-19 crisis, and doctors and healthcare workers are on the front line who are working tirelessly for the welfare of the patients and also to minimize the damage to the society. But in this juncture, this news article mentions that salaries have not been paid to the doctors working at some hospitals of the North Delhi Municipal Corporation since March 2020. Therefore, the North Delhi Municipal Corporation Doctors Association has written to the Lieutenant Governor to receive his attention to this particular matter. Now, based on these instances, this third news article mentions that Lieutenant Governor of Delhi seems to have taken over COVID-19 management in the Union Territory. It also mentions another instance because on June 6th, the Chief Minister of Delhi announced a decision to reserve Delhi hospitals for residents of Delhi only. But the next day, this decision was overruled by the Lieutenant Governor. It was overruled based on Section 14 of the Disaster Management Act of 2005. It is because as per this section, for the Delhi Disaster Management Authority, it is the Lieutenant Governor or LG who is the chairperson. And the Chief Minister is only the Vice Chairperson. But remember, with respect to Puducherry, the Chief Minister is the Chairperson of Puducherry Disaster Management Authority. So in this scenario, it becomes important to know about the role of Lieutenant Governor in the National Capital Territory of Delhi. See, we know that Articles 239 to 241 in Part 8 of Indian Constitution deals with the Union Territories. Though they are called as Union Territories, the administrative systems are not uniform among all of them. Because we know that the UTs of Puducherry and Delhi are provided with a legislative assembly and a council of ministers headed by the chief minister. And as per the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act of 2019, the UT of JNK will also have a legislative assembly. And all other UTs do not have a legislative assembly. And also remember the 69th Constitutional Amendment Act of 1991, which is with reference to Union Territory of NCT of Delhi. It came into force in 1992. The amendment inserted two new articles, which are Articles 239AA and 239AB into the Constitution. These articles provided for a legislative assembly for Delhi. Also, the Government of NCT of Delhi Act of 1991 was passed to supplement these articles. So in this scenario, it becomes important to know about Delhi Legislative Assembly also. Know that it consists of 70 members and all of them are directly elected. And the constitution lays down that the strength of the Council of Ministers shall not be more than 10% of the total number of members in the assembly. And know that the assembly has the power to make laws with respect to all the matters in the state list or in the concurrent list, but there is exception. This power is except for the entries of 1, 2, 18, 64, 65 and 66 in the state list as far as they relate to the public order, police and land. See, in this, entry 1 is about public order, entry 2 is police and entry 18 is with regarding to land. And the entry 64, 65, 66 is regarding these matters as you can see here. So that means the Delhi Legislative Assembly do not have powers to make laws with respect to public order, police, land and all these issues. And additionally, know that the Chief Minister of Delhi is appointed by the President. The President also appoints other ministers on the advice of the Chief Minister. And the ministers hold office during the pleasure of the President. This is as per Article 239 AA of Indian Constitution. So what is the connection between the Chief Minister of Delhi and the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi? Know that the Chief Minister and the Council of Ministers aids and advises the LG of Delhi in exercise of his functions in relation to matters on which Legislative Assembly has the power to make laws. But often we hear news about the power tussle between the Chief Minister and his Council of Ministers and the Lieutenant Governor. So there have been demands from several sections to grant complete statehood to Delhi. In this case of Delhi, the central government through the Lieutenant Governor handles the portfolios of land, police and public order. In that regard, the LG of Delhi holds more power than a governor of a state. Remember this fact. In this background only, the Supreme Court has given its verdict in 2018, which has broadly settled many issues between the LG and the CM of Delhi. Supreme Court held that the LG is bound by the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers and the LG must follow the decisions of the Cabinet on all matters where the Legislative Assembly has the power to make laws. It also held that except for issues of public order, police and land, the LG is bound by the aid and advice of the elected government and the real authority to take decisions lie in the elected government only. Here if you note that according to Article 239 AA, when there is a difference of opinion between LG and the Council of Ministers on any matter, the administrator may refer the matter to the President and act according to the decision of the President. And with regard to this article, Supreme Court observed that here any matter does not mean every matter. So Supreme Court noted that not every trivial difference of opinion between LG and NCT government has to be referred to the President for a decision. So the issues which are referred should be of substantive importance or national importance. The court also observed that the elected government only need to inform the LG of its well-deliberated decisions. The government need not obtain his concurrence in every issue of day-to-day governance for which the elected government is to act upon. This is because requiring prior concurrence of the LG would absolutely negate or nullify the ideals of representative governance and democracy which is conceived for the NCT of Delhi by Article 239 AA of Indian Constitution. So this topic is very important from examination perspective because there were also questions in GS2 mains paper regarding the tussle between the CM of Delhi and Lieutenant Governor of Delhi. So you can take note of all these points noted by Supreme Court. It will be helpful in answering a question regarding Lieutenant Governor as administrator. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question we discussed in the last session. Now, this news article talks about the Lonar Lake, which is a notified National Geoheritage Monument. So, in this discussion, we'll see why this lake is in news. We'll also see some other information about this lake. And then finally, we'll also see what is National Geoheritage Monument. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now see, this Lonar Lake is located in the Buldana district of Maharashtra and it is in news for a very unique reason. Because recently the color of the lake has turned into pink or we can say orangish red. So samples were collected and sent to research institutes to identify the possible causes for this color change. Even in this picture you can see the color change of this lake. Some experts believe that the mixing of Junalela algae with halobacteria might have formed the red-orange colored beta pink. ligament, and this causes the change in color. See, Dunalila is a unicellular biflagellate green algae, and these Dunalila species are commonly observed in salt lakes in all parts of the world, from tropical regions to temperate regions to polar regions, where they often impart an orange-red color to the water. It is because the chloroplast of this species accumulates large quantities of beta-carotene. So the cell appears orange-red rather than green. You would have heard about the beta-carotene. Even the citrus fruits, carrots and tomatoes owe their typical color of red-orange mainly to this beta-carotene only. And the halobacteria is nothing but a halophilic microorganism, which means they grow in extremely high salinity environment. So experts believe that the mixing of this algae and this bacteria has caused this red-orange color to the lake. So this was the news. Now let us see some other information about this lake. See, this Lonar Crater Lake is a lake of lagoon which is present in the Deccan Plateau in Maharashtra. Lonar Crater is a saline and alkaline lake created by a meteorite impact which happened about 52,000 years ago. See, when we say crater, it means it is a circular depression in the surface of a planetary body. Most craters are result of impacts of meteorites or even because of volcanic explosion. And this Lonar Lake was discovered by British officer J. E. Alexander, and it was discovered in 1823. And this lake has a mean diameter of 1.2 kilometers and it is about 137 meters below the crater rim, that is from the edge of the crater. And know that this lake is surrounded by ancient temples, natural beauty and rich biodiversity. And the most famous temple in this region is Gomukh Temple. Then there is also another temple which resembles the erotic sculptures of Khajuraho in Madhya Pradesh. Not only that, the Lonar Lake is a bird watcher's paradise. And because of this, the region surrounding this Lonar Crater was declared as a wildlife sanctuary. And in the beginning, we saw that Lonar Lake is a notified National Geoheritage Monument. See, when the biodiversity found in geological formations of the earth, such as rocks, fossils, minerals, and geological processes, create a distinctive formation, then it is known as geodiversity. And this kind of geodiversity is entitled the name of geoheritage when a certain uniqueness or value is attributed to that geodiversity. And these geoheritage sites encompass significant elements which possess educational, scientific, aesthetic value and even cultural values. And know that the Geological Survey of India has undertaken the responsibility of protection and promotion of such areas of geoheritage. And so far, GSI has declared 26 geoheritage sites which are located in different parts of our country. And they are known as the National Geological Monuments. And if these monuments are included in the tourist maps, then the visitors from other country or even from our country can also have an insight in the real past about the earth, that is such as the formation of the subcontinent. They can have an insight on the orogeny, which is a process in which a section of earth's crust is folded and deformed by a lateral compression to form a mountain range. This process is known as orogeny. And they can even have some insight on exotic collection of paleo flora and fauna, that is the older flora and fauna. And these are the 26 sites that has been declared by GSI as National Geological Monuments. It may be difficult to remember all the sites, so you can use the trick of first remembering the site which is from your state or from your adjacent state. Then slowly you can learn about the monuments in other states. Now in this, note that from Maharashtra, only this Lonar Lake has been given the status of National Geological Monument or a National Geoheritage Monument. So that is all about this news article. In this discussion, we saw why the Lonar Lake was in news. We also saw some of the important facts about Lonar Lake, and we also saw about the status of National Geological Monument. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now, this discussion is based on this news article which talks about forex reserves. The news article mentions that India's forex reserves increased by $8.2 billion during 1 week to reach the $500 billion mark. And this is the first time this $500 billion mark has been reached. Now, this sharp increase in forex is because of the gains made by rupee as dollar depreciated against all the major currencies. Now, because of the increase in forex reserve, India now has reserves to meet an import cover of about 14 months. See, import cover measures the number of months of imports that can be covered with foreign exchange reserves, which is available with the central bank of the country, that is RBI in our context. And it is said that for the stability of a currency, 8 to 10 months of import cover is essential. Now know that the foreign exchange reserves consist of foreign currency assets, gold reserves, special drawing rights in IMF, and then reserve tranche position in the IMF. If you look at the total composition of Forex, foreign currency assets, that is FCAs, constitute the largest portion. FCAs are maintained as a multi-currency portfolio which comprises of major currencies such as US dollar, euro, pound sterling, Japanese yen, etc. And these currencies are valued in terms of US dollars. Now next is special drawing rights, that is SDRs. They are an artificial currency instrument created by the International Monetary Fund in the year 1969. IMF uses them for internal accounting purposes, and the value of SDR is calculated from a weighted basket of major currencies such as US dollar, euro, Japanese yen, Chinese renminbi, and British pound. And know that the SDR interest rate, which in short known as SDRI, provides the basis for calculating the interest rate charged from the member countries when they borrow from IMF. And additionally, know that SDRI is the interest rate paid to members for their remunerated creditor positions in the International Monetary Fund. Now, next is the reserve tranche position of India in IMF. See, IMF is funded through its members and their quota contributions. The reserve tranche is basically an emergency account that IMF members can access at any time without agreeing to conditions or without paying a service fee. In other words, a portion of a member country's quota can be withdrawn free of charge at its own discretion. Now, the next and fourth component is gold reserves. And these gold reserves are maintained by RBI. The value of gold reserves is expressed either in US dollars or in Indian rupee. And know that India is the 10th largest country in the world in terms of gold reserves. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the components of Forex reserves. Now, this displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Let us move on to the next discussion. Now, this next discussion is based on this news article, which talks about a state-of-the-art flood warning system. This system is the iFLOWS Mumbai. It has been developed by the Ministry of Earth Sciences with the in-house expertise and coordination with the Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. We know that the recent cyclone Nisarga made landfall near Alibaug in Raigad district of Mumbai last week. Now, since Maharashtra had received warning about this cyclonic storm 2-3 days in advance, the state government was able to shift people to safer locations, and hence the loss of human life was drastically reduced. And also, as we know, Mumbai city has been experiencing floods with increasing periodicity, and it is in need of an early flood warning system to ensure the safety and security of the people. In this scenario only, this flood warning system has been developed. It is one of the most advanced integrated flood warning systems, and it will keep the Mumbai city, which has been experiencing floods with increasing periodicity. The high-tech system will predict floods before they occur, thereby it will enable the city to take due precautions in advance. That means iFLOWS Mumbai is a monitoring and flood warning system that will be able to relay alerts of possible flood prone areas anywhere between 6 to 72 hours in advance. The system uses rain gauge data and local data such as data on land use, land topography, drainage systems, water bodies in the city, infrastructure, population, which has been provided by the Municipal Corporation of Mumbai. Now, using these inputs, the prediction system models weather, rainfall, runoff, and water movement. It models tide and storm surge impacts, and based on these, early flood warnings for the city will be provided. It will address the flood inundation due to rainfall, due to river bank breach, due to storm surge, due to obstruction of flow caused by roads, buildings, rail lines, high tides, and sea level rise. And just know that this system comprises of these 7 modules. And the system can provide all information regarding possible flood-prone areas, also about the likely height of the flood water. It can also provide location-wise problem areas, and it could also calculate the vulnerability and risk of elements which will be exposed to floods. So that means the urban flooding, which is very common in Mumbai city, that happens from June to September and which results in the crippling of traffic, railways and airlines, can be mitigated through this flood warning system. And this system will help to warn the citizens so that they can be prepared in advance for the flooding conditions. This will boost the city's resilience by providing early warning for flooding, especially during high rainfall events and cyclones. I know that a similar system was already developed by Ministry of Earth Sciences and is in operation in Chennai. And according to this news article, Bengaluru and Kolkata may also get a similar system by 2021. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the iFlows Mumbai system, which has been developed by Ministry of Earth Sciences. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question we discussed in the last session. Now we have come to the last session for the day, which is the practice questions discussion session. This question is with reference to Foreign Exchange Reserve of India. The first statement mentions the foreign currency assets, which is a multi-currency portfolio comprising of major currencies, constitute the largest portion in Forex reserve. So this statement has two parts. First, whether it is a multi-currency portfolio comprising of major currencies. Yes, it is. Then whether it is the largest portion in Forex reserve. Yes, it is the largest portion. So first statement is correct. And here the question asks for the correct statements. So you can eliminate option C and D. Now the second statement mentions special drawing rights is a portion of a member country's quota in IMF that can be withdrawn free of charge at its own discretion. And if you read the third statement, it mentions reserve transposition is an artificial currency instrument created by the IMF whose value is calculated from a weighted basket of major currencies. Now, if you see, second statement actually talks about reserve transposition and third statement actually talks about the SDRs, that is special drawing rights. So the statements have been incorrectly given. So both the statements are not correct. So the correct answer to this question is option A, one only. Now this next question is based on National Capital Territory of Delhi. The first statement mentions the Legislative Assembly can make laws on all the matters of state list and concurrent list. Now this statement is incorrect because during discussion we saw that the Legislative Assembly of Delhi can make laws on all matters of state list and concurrent list, but except three matters which are on the state list, they are regarding public order, police and land. So that means first statement is incorrect. Now the second statement mentions the chief minister is appointed by the lieutenant governor. Now this statement is also incorrect because we saw that CM is appointed by the president and even other ministers are appointed by the president on the advice of chief minister. So second statement is also incorrect. Now the third statement is in case of difference of opinion between the LG and ministers including chief minister, the decision of LG prevails. Now this statement is incorrect because if there is a difference of opinion between LG and ministers, then the matter will be referred to the president for decision and the lieutenant governor has to act accordingly. So this statement is also incorrect. And here if you see the question asks for the incorrect statements. So be careful while marking the correct answer because option A mentions none of the above. Option D mentions all the above. Here all the options are incorrect and that is what has been asked by the question. So the correct answer is option D. Now this next question is with reference to iFlows Mumbai. The question asks which of the following statements with reference to iFlows Mumbai recently seen in news is or are correct. First statement is it has been developed by Ministry of Science and Technology in coordination with Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. Now this statement is incorrect because this has been developed by the Ministry of Earth Sciences in coordination with Municipal Corporation of Greater Mumbai. Now the second statement is it is an advanced flood warning system which will help Mumbai city to take precautions in advance. This statement is the correct statement about iFlows Mumbai system. So here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer is option B, two only. Now this next question is a two statement question. The first statement mentions the national geological monuments are areas of geoheritage declared by the Archaeological Survey of India. Now in this you have to verify two factors. One is whether it is areas of geoheritage. Yes, they are areas of geoheritage, but whether they are declared by Archaeological Survey of India? No, they are declared by Geological Survey of India. So be careful, just because it is about monuments, don't think it is declared by ASI. Now the second statement is the Lonar Lake created by a meteorite impact is the only national geological monument in Maharashtra. This statement is correct. And this was in news, so you should know about this lake. And here the question asks for the correct statements. So the correct answer is option B, two only. Now let us take one mains question based on GS paper 2. Discuss the possible factors that inhibit Indian education system from conducting live classes online to various learners. So you have to list the various factors. So in this you can highlight various setbacks faced by various learners right from the preconditions such as adequate ICT resources such as smartphones, internet availability, mobile network connectivity and then seamless connectivity etc. Then you can mention about the lack of universal availability of all these resources. So it hampers the system from conducting live online classes. And you can mention these resources are available in the country, but disproportionately, as these resources are not available in rural areas, remote areas, hilly terrains, in tribal villages. There are no resources or less resources. And you can mention this is not only true with reference to students or learners, but it is also true for educators or the teachers. And you can conclude by saying that even though these preconditions or prerequisites are available, online classes should not be advocated for classes up to 5th standard, because the mental well-being of the students may be affected. And we know that the early years of learning are important for the development of the child. So those kinds of classes should not be provided through live online classes. Rather, there should be teacher-student interaction. There should be interaction among the students also. There should be venue for debate. There should be venue for sharing ideas, etc., etc. So you can add your own viewpoints while discussing the possible factors. With this, we have come to the end of today's Hindi News Analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.